Namaste and welcome to the first session of Ayurveda Thinkathon with me, Dr. Chetali Samant, and we have our first guest here today, Dr. Sneha Bhagwat, all the way from Margao, Goa. How much should I say about Dr. Sneha, you know? We share the same alma mater of Govantak Ayurveda Mahavidyalaya, where Dr. Sneha was my senior, and she passed out. She completed her bachelor's in the year 2001. And her passion and ambition to learn more about Ayurveda led her to Pune, where she learned the intricacies of Ayurveda Panchakarma. Her clinical journey started in a small village in Goa called Kavelosim, where although the village is very small, it is very popular among international tourists. And that is what opened a whole wide world of possibilities for Dr. Sneha. Dr. Sneha's very keen interest in dietetics about people from different culinary backgrounds led her to devise very unique, diet, customized dietetics for people from different countries based on the principles of Ayurveda. A very expert Nadi Pariksha specialist, Dr. Sneha's clinical journey led her to finally open Urja Wellness Center, which is one of the only NABH Ayurveda accredited center in Goa. This was just the beginning. Dr. Sneha is now associated with Panchakarma centers, or five Panchakarma centers across Germany, Russia, UAE, and also the US. Her journey led her to opening another Panchakarma center in Moscow, Russia. Dr. Sneha's very keen interest and dedication towards her practice is very obvious because she has been awarded by the mayor of Sochi in Russia, and she was felicitated for her efforts about bringing about awareness to yoga and Ayurveda. Again, in 2017, she was felicitated by the Consul General of St. Petersburg in Russia for her efforts towards promoting yoga in Russia, which is amazing. She has pioneered, she is one of the few people who started an international practice of Ayurveda from Goa. Her list of achievements is very long, and we'll try to keep it, you know, due to the time constraint. Dr. Sneha, we'll keep it as much as we can today. We'll mention your achievements. She has deep awareness for her social responsibilities being a women entrepreneur, and her association with Rotary International led her to doing so many social initiatives for girls and women across Goa, and she has been felicitated with awards like Udyogini Puraskar and Dhanvantari Puraskar for her efforts both in the fields of social well-being and social services, as well as her efforts towards popularizing Ayurveda in Goa. It is a great pleasure to have you on board, Dr. Sneha. And, life has come to a full circle from our time in Govantak Ayurveda Mahavidyalaya to Ayurveda Thinkathon today. Welcome, I formally welcome you. We'll straight away go to the Thinkathon session today. Doctor, it's in the face of COVID-19 pandemic, we are now seeing that the face of Ayurveda practice is changing. While some doctors are worried as to how Ayurveda will be practiced in the wake of this pandemic, some people have stopped practicing, and some brave warriors like you have been practicing even in the times of pandemic. So we would like to start, I would like to ask you a first question. Being a person who has experienced different phases and different ways of practicing Ayurveda across the world, Doctor, how do you think that COVID-19 will help, whether it will help Ayurveda to find its, real place in the practice of, in today's world regarding Ayurveda practice? You know, what do you think, whether the potential of Ayurveda as a mainstream healthcare will be fulfilled alongside conventional medicine? What do you think, Doctor?
Yeah. So thank you, Dr. Chetali. And I wholeheartedly congratulate you to start this new kind of innovative series, which is Ayurveda Thinkathon. And I'm sure a lot of doctors will join in this series and give their views, discuss, and we come up with best practices in Ayurveda post-COVID-19, which we should take it as an opportunity. So the first question that you asked was what will be the stand of COVID-19, of Ayurveda post-COVID-19. Of course, Ayurveda, we know, is definitely a mainstream medicine. We cannot definitely say it as something which is alternative medicine or many of the bodies like ICMR have termed it as definitely alternative medicine, but it is not so. But now the challenge before us is, if our bureaucrats and the government, definitely government is supporting to a large extent, but if our bureaucrats and the government supports this pathy as an Indian system of medicine, we have a long way to go. And yes, definitely it is a mainstream medicine, according to me. Because not only because the results that we show, but overall in the world also, it has gained a lot of popularity and credentiality due to its scientific evidence that we have gained over practice. And it is not only us, but generations together who have been practicing Ayurveda with total confidence have proved this, that there is a scientific base to this, and we have to take it up as a challenge to get up this Ayurveda fraternity to a mainstream medicine all over the world, not only in India.
Correct. That's what I Correct. Mean. Yeah. Correct. Doctor, that is wonderful. I mean, even to have the confidence that, you know, we can do it and we can find our place in mainstream healthcare, and we are mainstream healthcare if we propagate Ayurveda in the right sense and we can show the potential of Ayurveda to the world. Definitely we are becoming mainstream now, and it's just for up to us that we have to step up to the challenge and do our best in this life. Doctor, my second question to you is, whether Ayurveda can emerge, or will it emerge as the future of preventive, proactive, and probably epigenetic medicine? Given the trend of health that we are seeing now, wherein pandemics might become the new reality for us, what do you think, doctor, as to what is the potential of Ayurveda for becoming preventive, proactive, and future of epigenetic medicine?
So here there are three aspects. First is preventive. Now, most of the people, not only in India, but all over the world, know the importance of preventive medicine as Ayurveda, because many a times we explain to our patients about Dinacharya, Rutucharya, and now after post-COVID, Absolutely. It has become more and more popular. The Ayush Ministry stepping into telling the world that if we have to have a better immunity, we should definitely follow our proper diet lifestyle that includes Dinacharya and Rutucharya. Along with that, Achar Rasayan, Ahar Rasayan also are of equal importance.
Absolutely.
So my suggestion to all the Ayurveda physicians is, when we are consulting a patient, we should definitely start also with Dinacharya and Rutucharya importance, explaining them, counseling them, and making them understand how Panchakarma, because this is our main pillar of practice, I should say. So how Panchakarma can help you to keep healthy, and prevention is much, as we all know, prevention is better than cure, but it is also cheaper and easier than cure. And Correct. The repair Correct. Mechanism Absolutely. That happens after the disease is formed, may be a lifestyle disorder, it is just a repair, but just for you not to go into that condition, it is always important to have regular Panchakarma, follow proper diet and lifestyle. And usually for health, there are three pillars. One is diet, exercise, and meditation. So all these come in our Dinacharya and Rutucharya. And if followed properly, it is definitely going to help Ayurveda to emerge. It is already emerged, rather, I should say. It's not only it will help, but it has already emerged. But we have to take it on at a larger scope.
Correct. Correct.
Then the second
Dr.
thing,
Yeah.
yeah. So the second thing what I feel is about as a preventive medicine, that I would add it onto it, that it could be also a predictive medicine more than preventive. Correct. We can also go into the second step as a predictive medicine. You wanted to say something?
Doctor, it's just that, in your international experience of practicing in different Panchakarma centers, what are the challenges that you have faced, like in explaining Ayurvedic Dinacharya to international, audience? For example, when I practiced in the US, I found them much more receptive because it was a very new thing for them. Although it took more time to explain them what is Ayurvedic Dinacharya, they were more interested in knowing it. According to your experience, how much do you think, doctor, that people are receptive towards again starting to follow Dinacharya and Ruchucharya, which demands them to be very disciplined?
See, now every country I have a different experience, because the demographics of every country is different, the climatic different. Conditions of every country are different. So accordingly, I have derived some measures to convince and to make people understand about the importance of Dinacharya. Of course, everywhere it can be followed, but Rutucharya is a little different, and for that I have done some modifications. Now when I'm explaining the importance of Dinacharya, see, Western people, we always know that they don't even brush in the morning. They have a they have a habit of bed tea, which is also coming to Indian people right now. So right from there, we have to start convincing them, and it should be in a proper scientific way. Like, why you should brush your teeth? What is the importance? When the saliva gets collected, there is some bacterial formation in your saliva. On the gums, there could be settling of some bacterial froth kind of
deposits,
thing.
So this
should not deposits. So this should not go into your stomach, which will again hamper your digestive system. So right, so it has to be explained in a scientific way. Similarly, also with nasyam, or you know, pratimarsha nasyam, wherein we apply coconut oil or ghee, why it is important, why you should do that. And I have found, after convincing, especially in cold climatic countries like Russia and US or in Germany, that people have come back to me and said that after started applying this oil or ghee, they have felt much more ease in breathing. Because when the climate is dry, definitely the breathing becomes little difficult after a certain time, or when you have a certain temperature. Also, the episodes of bleeding have reduced or even not there, you know. So this is what is, if we explain them the scientific approach about it, definitely they are going to follow. Secondly, what I have experienced is the people who are coming for Ayurveda, the Western people, I should say, they are already well read. Most of them, 80% are well read. They know what are the basic constituents of body, how we think about Vata, Pitta, Kapha. All these things are, you know, they read and they come. So it is just they want a proper counseling and proper scientific approach to be understood, and then they follow it. So that's one thing I have observed. Yeah.
So, doctor, it's like, you know, our understanding of their culture and their climatic condition is very important. It sits at the crux. Exactly. It's the crux of making it, you know, acceptable to more public. And probably each and every Ayurveda physician, unlike modern or conventional medicine, is an educator more than a physician. We educate people more than, you know, just giving and writing prescriptions is what one of the things that I learned from your this and also from my own experiences, that we are primarily educators of for people, especially when it comes to preventive and proactive medicine. Doctor, I would like to have your proceed with answering the question as to how it can emerge as the future of predictive and epigenetic medicine.
So in preventive, I was saying that it can also emerge as a predictive medicine, is because in predictive medicine, generally the modern science or the basic science people, what is done is the DNA analysis is done, and usually the genotyping is done, and with the hereditary strains that are being found out, which should not pass on to the next generation, so that the disease can be avoided or the symptoms or the impact can be minimized. So same way, even Ayurveda has told in our texts, we all know about it, about Prakriti Parikshan, body constitution assessments, about knowing even the family background of the bride and the groom. Usually I am doing Garbha Sanskar here on a large scale, so I know, I have to know the both the families, the bride and the groom families very well, and understand what are the hereditary problems that they have. And then after doing Prakruti Parikshan, before conception, I arrive at a proper Panchakarma receipt which should be given to both of them. So that helps, and that has proved to a lot extent that so many patients have, even with the second child, there is a lot of difference that patients have come with. So the acceptance is very good.
Yeah.
Secondly, I would also stress upon here that when we are saying it as a proactive medicine in Ayurveda, as a consultant, I would like to stress upon here that in Ayurveda, we forget about something called as referring patients. So what happens is any patient and every patient who comes to us, we try to treat them. But definitely Ayurveda has a, holistic knowledge, and Ayurveda is a holistic science. That is all correct. But when we are coming at a specialization, or when we know that, okay, a certain person has certain experience or has some research done on a particular subject, I think referral also is important for our pathy or for
Absolutely.
Our identity to grow to a great extent. Because when we refer, patient also has a confidence, and I have this experience, like, if a patient of asthma or a wound or piles or fistula comes, I directly tell them, okay, you have to go for a second opinion. I'm not saying that I refer you to this patient, but you have to go for a second opinion and then get back to me whatever has been told to you. And then we can finalize or we can work on it. And then that is how it goes. So in this way, what happens is there are two things that happen in this. One is the patient has a confidence that you will rightly Correct. Guide him or her. So the patient always believes you even in future. It's not, many of us fear that we might lose the patient, but actually Correct. It is not like that. Even I have referred active asthmatic cases to hospital, saying that now you need nebulization, and after nebulization you come to me for a proper asthmatic treatment. So this is the way I think we should head on, so that people build more and more confidence in Ayurveda. Second thing, one is referral. Second is, I would advise or I would stress upon testing also, because many a times we forget about diagnostic approach. So we just think that people, we do the prakriti analysis or dosh dushya understanding is done, and most of the times patient comes to us with diagnosis, so we just do the treatment based on that diagnosis. But we have to think little bit more in between the conditions, like how we say reading in between the lines. So I say that it is reading in between the symptoms, and understand how you can get him to first of all get a proper diagnosis of the patient. So for that, Correct. Testing is required. It may be any testing, ultrasound or hormonal assays or anything. As far as fertility, I am doing all this testing.
Correct.
So even I do AI test, immunity, IgG test. So it is important, and patient also feels confident that, okay, you know what you are doing and what is happening with you. So this is also one important step that as an Ayurveda practitioner, we should look into it. And that is how patient also has more confidence in you.
Correct. Doctor, I really liked your point that you made, that be open for referrals, And, your patient will not lose respect or trust in you that this doctor doesn't know about this particular condition, but their respect for you will in fact increase when you tell them that you have this particular condition for which I am not specialized. You need to go to this particular person. You can come for the aftercare to me. For example, if it is a surgically rectifiable condition, then you can get it rectified and then you come to me for rehabilitation. There is a large potential for Ayurveda in rehabilitation too. So I think that is one aspect which we really need to engrave into minds of even young physicians, or try to convince those who are already practicing. Second point, what I really liked is what you said about testing. And you are an expert in polycystic ovaries, and you treat a lot of patients with infertility in Goa. So I personally have observed in my practice that many a times people start with treatment of polycystic ovaries first and then do the diagnosis as an afterthought when they don't see the results, which is not really a very ethical practice, or which is not a very efficient way to do it. So I really liked what you said, that diagnose and read in between symptoms and, try to connect what you are seeing in the patient by doing the correct diagnosis. educating ourselves and coming up to date with what is going on in the field of diagnostic criteria. And diagnostic methods are not domain of any particular, pathy. It's a scientific technique, and anybody can make use of it for diagnosis. So that's a wonderful point that you did, doctor.
The diagnosis is basically the basic sciences that are used to understand the physiology or the pathology in the body. So it's not like, because you're an Ayurvedic physician, you should not go in for that, or only allopathy has the right to do that. Nothing like that. And it also gives us a lot of confidence, and we can show the evidence to the patient. Like the way you said, polycystic ovaries, when you do ultrasound or you do a hormonal test, you do all the hormonal assay, you do the thyroid test, they also understand, okay, Baba, after taking this 3 or 4 months medicine, now this is the result. Symptomatically, definitely patient feels better. But what about the, testing or the diagnostics or the results in the pathological conditions? So this is also important, I feel.
Correct. Doctor, you are an expert in Nadi Pariksha as well. And I have met a lot of people who say that Nadi Pariksha is sufficient in diagnostic diseases and we do not need a testing, So this is something which I think it's up to people to accept that, it is beneficial for their own practice that they convince patients for testing rather than relying on something which is subjective and only for you to know. The patients will not know what you saw in Nadi Pariksha, For the patient to understand what you diagnosed and how it worked out for them, diagnostic methods are a major tool. And I think, coming from you, it creates so much of impact that, why we need to inculcate these habits into our practice. And, another question I would want to say, when we see doctor that, we are doing diagnostic tests, many a times what happens is, for example, a patient with Prameha, or what we equate to type 2 diabetes now, or diabetes as a whole, as a group of conditions, there are so many things that the patient feels differently when they come to us for treatment. They feel a lot better, they feel more energetic, but many a times the results may not show into the blood test for a very long period of time. So considering their qualitative changes or subjective changes that they feel as a patient is so unique to Ayurveda, and what would you like to say about that? That how a patient feels with your treatment is also very crucial towards making Ayurveda mainstream, where we reinstate the confidence in patients that how you feel also is equally more important. Not just because many patients we have seen that they feel that only seeing results in terms of blood tests means that they are completely cured of a disease, and they completely ignore as to how they feel. Like when somebody comes to you, they will just put a file in front of you and expect you to understand everything about them by looking at their past reports. Whereas it might form some part of their case taking, a whole different part forms about many subjective things that they feel, which are described better in Ayurveda as compared to conventional medicine. What do you have to say that about that, doctor?
See, in our health or Arogya definition, it is already there that Prasanna Atma Indriya and Mana. Prasanna Atma Indriya Sat. So this is the first thing that I would like to understand or, tell the patient that when you start feeling better, or when so much of laghav is there, for example, or when your pain is relieved, or when you, for example, in diabetes, suppose you have excess maturation, feeling of maturation, or appetite is sometimes vague. So all these symptoms are the first step of your treatment, because in diabetes, we don't directly, because you asked about diabetes, I'm saying about diabetes. In diabetes, we don't directly concentrate on the sugar levels like the modern medicine. We actually help the body to improve the insulin absorption. Okay,
absolutely.
So that is what we expect in a long term, so that you don't take medicines for long time, or maybe you are on minimum dosage of medicines. And secondly, your complications or your other organs are protected. Your complications are prevented. So there would be no complications, and whatever organs damage would have been happened with modern medicine, that is also protected. So these kind of things you need to keep counseling to patients. So as I said earlier also, you have to talk to patients more more efficiently, and try to make them understand what you are doing and what is your thought process behind doing that. So that is one important aspect for the patient to understand that, okay, I am being treated in a in a protective way, and which will help me in the long run. So this is not short-term benefits that we are looking at. Okay, today you take diabetes, maybe glycophage or metformin, and tomorrow your sugar shows that you are normal. But this is not the actual thing that we want, because this is just a medicine effect that is there.
Correct.
But what we are doing with Ayurvedic treatment or with Ayurvedic scientific approach is we are trying to take care of your whole body and making your insulin absorption better. So this is what I think is important as a physician to explain to the patient.
That is excellent, doctor. I mean, for people to even take this much of time and educate patients about it and explaining them that when you come to Ayurveda, you're not coming merely to receive a prescription from us. That any doctor can do, you know. Yeah. The whole purpose of coming for Ayurveda is so that your dependency on doctors as a whole goes down.
Yes.
And many people feel that, you know, a patient should keep coming back to them again and again because it's good for business. Nobody addresses the business side of running Ayurveda. Probably I would love to have another session with you to understand what it means to be a woman entrepreneur, you know, in this area. So that's a whole different topic for discussion. But many people feel that, you know, setting patients free is not so good for running a clinic. But that's not true. If you make one patient independent, that patient has the potential to send so many others to you because of the way you treated them and set them free, you know. Isn't it, doctor?
Yeah, definitely, that's true, and I have experienced it practically also in my practice. Even patients from abroad, now they are taking medicine, most of the, even when they call also, I don't tell them that, okay, you go and take this medicine. First of all, we just try to understand what is the situation, what must have happened, what is the diet that he has taken, and try to counsel them and make them understand, okay, you wait for 2 days, even if it is a viral infection or any kind of fever or cough or anything like this, he can still be managed with some home remedies or some proper diet and lifestyle that he can take. And it can continue, if it continues to get better, then no need of intervening it with medicines. So this also is an important aspect, like how you deal with the patient and make the patient understand the scientific approach of your treatment. That is very Absolutely. Important as far as a practitioner, I feel, because patient, as you said rightly, patient doesn't come with a with a intention to just take prescriptions to Ayurveda physician. And even if he comes, we have to change his approach, saying that, see, only writing medicines and prescriptions will not help you in long run. It is important that you yourself understand your body and try to Absolutely. Take your body towards Perfect. Healthy feeling, rather than, you know, just keep taking pills and popping pills. So that is our success, I should say. Not only our individual success, but it's our success.
Our success. Absolutely, doctor. I agree 100% with what you said about, you know, how you explained as to how we are becoming mainstream now and how we are changing the whole outlook towards health, you know, for people. It was great discussing these two questions with you. We have so much more, like when me and Sneha spoke, we have so much more to discuss when it comes to how we can make ourselves better practitioners or how we can change the face of the practice. We both being women entrepreneurs, there are so many parallels in our life or the course our life has taken in the past few years that we know each other. And it is so inspiring. I would compliment you, Dr. Sneha, openly on this platform that you are so inspiring. I mean, from the time in the college till now, if somebody even follows the growth curve that you have had, there is so much for people to learn from that. That how you persevered and understood as to how we have to change the face of Ayurveda practice. Because from the from what where we come from, how we have learned. We have both learned from the same kind of backgrounds, but how you understood as to what you can bring to the table as a practitioner and never held yourself back from doing things that you are doing now, it is very inspirational. And that is the main aim of Ayurveda Thinkathon, to bring forward people who can be potential role models for upcoming Ayurveda physicians. India churns out Ayurveda graduates by the ton every year. How many end up becoming actually practitioners or international practitioners? There's so much potential in each and every student that, where we churn out, and each and every practitioner who practices in our society. And as long as they get good role models like you, there is so much for them to learn and to shape their careers. I thank you so much for joining today's Thinkathon session.
it was very nice interacting with you. And I would, you know, I'm not a very great practitioner or nothing like that. Yeah, of course, many.
You are very humble, doctor.
My best, whatever possible, to ease the patient, to give patient best health care, and trying to also uplift the Ayurveda fraternity just as a, you know, normal course of requirement, I feel, and it is very much necessary. And secondly, I would recommend to all the doctors, especially the women entrepreneurs, that nothing is impossible. And if we study deep into each and every aspect, if we understand what we want and how we should go ahead, then definitely nothing is impossible, and we should keep trying. That's what I feel. And thank you so much for inviting me, and hopefully we'll have more series. And I congratulate you for this special innovative thing that you are doing, Ayurveda Thinkathon. Definitely it's going to bring a lot of practitioners under one platform, and I would request all the practitioners that they come under one platform and discuss and understand and try to get more and more solutions to each one's practice. Thank you so much.
Thank you, doctor. Your humility says it all. May God bless you with more and more success, good health and happiness. Thank you so much for joining today's session. It was really great and really intellectually stimulating to talk to you. Thank you so much, doctor. Good night.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you, doctor.